last year, at our NECSSS conference, John was our last speaker of the conference. And his mission, it was to sort of be dapper and to kind of prod us into examining ourselves and taking a look at the various ways, correct me if I'm wrong, you know, the various things that we could possibly improve on ourselves. And he left 20 minutes at the end of his lecture for a Q&A. And our MC was so offended by what he said that he pushed him off the stage. And John never really got a chance to have him play with the audience.
One of the high points of my career, actually.
Well, it was one of the high points. Well, it stood out. That's something that people will remember for many years to come. So we thought that was not appropriate, and we wanted to give John a chance to come to us if we were wrong. And we're going to flip the bird.
It's coming through? Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me back. I had a great time at the conference last spring, actually. I met a lot of great people and had a wonderful discussion in the lobby outside the auditorium afterwards. So even though Jamie Swiss, I think his name is, he didn't let me do a Q&A with the audience, I essentially had one afterwards, and we had some really great conversations. So I've been thinking about what to say here. I mean, there are a lot of different things that I could say. There are a lot of things that I mentioned in my talk that I care a lot about, and I wish other people, and especially people who identify as skeptics, care about. One of the things I'm best known for is that science is limited, and a certain kind of science in its grandest mode, pure science, might be over now. That's my book, The End of Science. I don't like the idea that I think is implicit and sometimes explicit in skeptics meetings, that science needs people to cheer for it and celebrate it and tell people how great it is. I see science as so powerful that I, as a science journalist, see it as my responsibility to counteract the marketing and promotion of science. Another really important issue that I tried to touch on is that it's easy to distinguish between so-called real science and pseudoscience. That's the demarcation problem with which Massimo Pigliucci talks about a lot. I could even have dwelled on people in the skeptics movement or celebrated by the skeptics movement that I don't think are good people. I won't name any names. Okay, there's one right there. So, and there are ideas in various fields of science that I think are arguably pseudoscientific. And it's remarkable to me that physics, the so-called hardest of all hard sciences, is propagating a lot of very weakly or completely unsupported theories these days. And here are some. As we've all heard about string theory, multiverses are very hot these days. And even the idea that we live in a virtual universe, Neil deGrasse Tyson and others have talked about this. This is all just sheer speculation. There is no empirical support for any of these things. Biology, things that really drive me crazy are, these again are things that I mentioned last spring. Behavioral genetics, which I call gene whiz science, finding a gene for all these complicated traits and disorders. Evolutionary psychology, which also is coming up with very deterministic theories of human behavior that often are very poorly supported. In neuroscience, there's a fascinating trend these days toward what I call neo-geocentrism. This was really on display at a conference that I went to 2 weeks ago. I've got intellectual whiplash right now. I was at a conference hosted by Deepak Chopra. And we can talk about that afterwards. What was remarkable was that it was loaded. It was a 3-day conference. I was the token skeptic. Professors from Harvard, other leading institutions who were very much sympathetic toward Chopra's views on science and medicine. And the main theme of the conference was that materialism is dead. Reality is made of consciousness. This is what I call neo-geocentrism. I'd love to talk about that. I've been writing about it a lot.
You're not confusing him with us, are you?
What I'm saying, this goes back to the demarcation problem, that mainstream science and so-called fringe pseudoscience, the boundary between them is very blurry. This is one of the things I was trying to say last spring. There are big problems in medicine that I dwell on a lot, especially the two areas I write about a lot are psychiatry and oncology treatments and tests for cancer, where there are just tremendous problems. And especially in psychiatry, the over-treatment of people with drugs for very common disorders like depression and anxiety. So those are all things. If you want to ask me about any of those at the end of my talk, I'd be delighted to. Or ask me, you know, what is Deepak Chopra like in person? We're like that now. We're really chummy. But I want to talk about the issue that is most important to me, and that I feel is really getting insufficient attention from scholars, journalists, and just the public, which is the idea that war is inevitable. So that's what I'm going to talk about now. I want to start off by asking this group, what's your answer to this question? How many of you think that there will be a period, and not, you know, like 1,000 years from now, or after aliens invade the Earth, you know, after there's a global nuclear war and we go back to hunter-gatherer conditions? How many of you think that the end of war between nations could happen relatively soon? Let's say by the end of the century. How many of you think that? Oh, this is a really optimistic crowd. I saw like 4 hands go up. How many of you think that is quite unlikely? Okay, and then some people are on the fence. I've been surveying people for 13 years now on this question, thousands of people in the US and Europe, online and talks like this. I ask every one of my classes, I teach at an engineering school across the river, about 90% of the people who respond to this question say war is a permanent part of the human condition. Terrible fatalistic view in my point. And often people who have this view when I ask them to explain themselves, they have various versions of this explanation that war is in our genes, it's part of human nature, it's just the way we are. And if they get more explicit, they say, we've always fought and we always will. Something along these lines. So here are some people who have either explicitly endorsed this idea or at least implicitly. One is Hillary Clinton, who read a book that is like the manifesto of the idea that war is has very deep roots and is innate. Donald Rumsfeld, McNamara, these are secretaries of defense, both are on record as saying that war is part of human nature, and that's one reason why we will never get rid of it. At the West Point Museum, have any of you been to this? West Point, 30, 40 miles north of here. I used to live right across the river from it. There's this wonderful museum that celebrates the ingenuity of humans in creating more and more methods for annihilating each other. Starts with stone axes and goes up to the atomic bomb. And there are all these plaques about war through the museum, and one says, "War is an aspect of human nature that will continue." Barack Obama, when he was accepting the Nobel Peace Prize, of all things, in 2009, said, "War appeared with the first man. We will not eradicate violent conflict in our lifetime." So he was saying, it's one thing to say that war is innate. It's another to say that it might be very difficult to eradicate because of that. And that is what Obama was basically saying. In 2009, he reiterated this just last summer when he gave a talk in Hiroshima. The reason this matters to me so much, and I hope you see the logic here, is that if we have this fatalistic view, the public, and especially our leaders, that can be a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you think the world is intrinsically dangerous and violent because that's how humans are, you're going to want to have a very strong defense, a very strong military, to make sure that when wars break out, which of course they will, you are going to win those wars. So there are policy implications to this view. So I want to quickly review some of the evidence for the deep roots theory of war. Here are some prominent proponents. These are leading scientists. Richard Wrangham, an anthropologist at Harvard, an authority on chimpanzees. Steven Pinker, I'm sure you're all familiar with, another Harvard person. Edward Wilson, I sometimes, if I'm in a really bad mood, call these guys the Harvard Hawks. Jared Diamond. And I just thought, even, you know, who doesn't fit? I thought I'd throw in Mike Shermer because this is a skeptics conference. All these people have very vigorously defended the idea that war has deep evolutionary roots. It's innate. And I'm not just talking about aggression. It's lethal group aggression, a very particular manifestation of aggression. Two main lines of evidence these days. One comes from archaeology, looking deep into the past behavior of humans early in civilization and before civilization. And another, anthropology, which looks at the behaviors of people who are still living a hunter-gatherer existence or something close to it and are seen as possibly resembling the behavior of our ancestors. And there's an estimate that is very commonly bandied about by the deep roots proponents that the mortality rate from group violence was about 15% prior to civilization among hunter-gatherers. The other common line of evidence that I'm sure you've heard about comes from chimpanzees, our closest genetic relative. This is something that Wrangham in particular is an authority on. So beginning in the 1970s, Jane Goodall and others who were observing chimpanzees saw that sometimes members, usually males, in one group would form a raiding party and go out on a search and destroy mission. If they caught members of a neighboring troop, they would beat that neighbor to death and often eat it. Very violent. You can find videos online showing these attacks. So the most extreme example or version of this theory that again is supported by all these people and varying degrees of vehemence is that war, lethal group violence, goes all the way back to the common ancestor with chimpanzees. This is before the emergence of the Homo genus. We're talking 6-7 million years ago. That's how old war is. All right, so here's some of the counter evidence to this this theory. The chimpanzee raids, it's extraordinary how much attention they get because these killings are actually quite rare. I put quotes around that because that comes from Richard Wrangham himself, who was pressed on the frequency of these killings, and he admitted that they are rare, even though then he says that this is innate behavior. So on average, you have one troop, which can be anywhere from 25 to 100 chimpanzees. You have a scientist observing one troop for 28 years, and you will, on average, see one killing. One killing. And I had to comb through the statistics to figure this out. You would never get that by reading either the original papers by the scientists or the popular coverage. Right. Yeah, this doesn't count killing within a tribe, which is seen as a very different thing. Then there's this other, you've probably heard about the bonobos, this other species of chimpanzees, the so-called hippie chimps. They make love, not war. And they actually can be very aggressive and violent toward each other, but there hasn't been a single killing observed among bonobos in the decades that they've been observed. Here's another thing that's really important to understand, that the oldest clear-cut evidence of group violence is about 12,000 years old. It's a mass grave along the Nile that was actually discovered back in the 60s. And that is an outlier. It's a couple of thousand years before almost all the other evidence of group violence. Yeah. Pardon me? Yes, and so what, the reason what we know that these are humans killing humans is there's some really obvious evidence. They're hack marks that were obviously produced by stone or metal later on, metal tools. Points, spear points or arrow points embedded in bones, bastion skulls, and that sort of thing. Now, there have also been studies where scientists gathered all the skeletal remains or did a survey of all the studies of humans and hominid remains going back as far as they go. And there are signs of violent death that could be attributed to human in less than 1%. Of these bones. And I just want to point out that, again, Pinker and the others are saying it was a mortality rate of 15%, and there are others who say higher. Yeah?
Do you happen to know about the scale of the global population
density? So is it the proximity of other people that plays a major role in climate versus the ability out of the plains to a time? Did you want to have a chance to meet your climate? I'm going to get to the relation between war and population density soon. Because that's a good point. Here's some more counter evidence. So there's an absence of war, except for this one outlier at about 12,000 years ago along the Nile. There's virtually no evidence around the world of group violence before 10,000 years ago. And then you start seeing it, you start seeing a lot of it, especially in the Middle East. The first really serious group conflict evidence emerged in Mesopotamia, figures, about 10,000 years ago. And then it's almost continuous since then. Yes?
Is that transition from very little to
It more or less, but not entirely, and this is a really important point. There is evidence that hunter-gatherer groups, nomadic hunter-gatherer groups, before humans started settling down, were engaging in warfare. This is a big source of confusion in the debate over when war began. Now, I want to point out that a common response to saying, well, there's no evidence of war before 10,000 years ago is, well, there's no evidence of anything 10,000 years ago. The evidence is so sparse for humans in general, and that's just not true. There is evidence for all sorts of what you might call cultural transitions, innovations, going back much further. So, you know, the origin of stone tools goes back way before Homo sapiens, back to the beginning, back to Homo erectus. Cooking is ancient. Burials, musical instruments, drawings, tens of thousands of years. Pottery is 20,000 years ago. Some of these things started at the before the Neolithic, before people really started settling down. We were still hunter-gatherers, but still lots of invention going on, leaving evidence in the archaeological record. All right, so then the question is, if war emerged fairly recently, what caused it? And what causes the variability of war? If you're trying to understand the origins of war, the causes of war, first thing that strikes you is that war is so sporadic. It's not like, you know, we say language is innate. One reason is because every single culture has it, right? That is a truly innate trait. You can find people to debate that. But war is nothing like that. Lots of societies that show no warlike behavior for centuries or millennia. This is another striking thing about the archaeological record. So that takes me to the population resource competition theory. It's very common, also propagated by the Harvard Hawks, especially a guy named Stephen LeBlanc, who's an anthropologist. At Harvard, and it seems just like common sense. It obviously goes back to Malthus's idea that inevitably all organisms overproduce for their environment, and then bad things are going to happen: violence, famine, disease, and so forth to cull the population. So LeBlanc wrote this book, Constant Battles. This is maybe 10 years ago, got a lot of attention. And this is the theme. War is the inevitable consequence of ecological demographic propensities. In other words, too many humans for the available resources, and so we end up fighting each other. What's fascinating to me about this idea is it's very popular right now, and it's popular with two groups that otherwise don't have a whole lot in common. The Pentagon loves it because it's another justification for keeping their budgets high, and also Bill McKibben and other leading environmentalists are all over this, and they're warning that global warming is going to lead to catastrophic conflict. This is an idea that you see all over the place.
Aren't you concerned about that? That global warming might lead to global wars?
I'll get to that. I'm not. I think it's again an area where our fear might be self-fulfilling. If we think that this is likely, that might lead us to have certain policies and defense security priorities that make water wars more likely. That's what I worry about.
John, don't you think a strong defense can actually deter war?
I think that the United States over the last 15 years has shown the fallacy of that kind of thinking. That we have the strongest defense in the world, and yet our policies have. Yeah, this is going to be toward the end of my talk. I'll get back to that. But
that. Stop us
from being
invaded. Pardon me?
Yeah, the old notion of war as conquest is, I think, actually becoming obsolete. Again, I'll get to that a little bit later. I just want to point out that the Malthusian theory is, I mean, again, it seems very commonsensical, but it's simply not supported by the literature, by research. There are these anthropologists at Yale who had a giant cross-cultural database, looked at all these different cultures, large and small, old and modern, and they would test various hypotheses about war, and they found a very weak correlation between violent conflict and resource scarcity. Napoleon Chagnon is a really interesting figure. Some of you might have heard of the Yanomamo, this tribe in the Amazon that Chagnon studied back in the 60s. He observed them engaging in war as a kind of sport, endless feuding, very high mortality levels. And he wrote about them, wrote one of the, I think it's actually the best-selling work of ethnography of all time, The Fierce People, Yanomamo, The Fierce People. And Chagnon found a reverse correlation between resource scarcity and war. In other words, he said that when the Yanomamo were well-fed and feeling really great, they were more likely to engage in feuds and attacks and war. I think the wars that have happened since the Industrial Revolution started enormously increasing prosperity, especially in Europe and in the United States, is another counterexample to the Malthusian theory of war. Yes. Yes. Yeah, and so it often starts with, let's say, two men. One finds his friend having sex with his wife, and so then he kills him. And then the brothers of the dead guy attack the murderer, and then it becomes a blood feud between the families. After a while, the initial cause is forgotten. It becomes an endless cycle of vengeance, which is true of war in general. I'm going to get to that in a second. Here's a really fascinating book by a really interesting person, Lewis Fry Richardson, a British mathematical physicist. He's one of the godfathers of chaos theory, created some of the first numerical weather models. And he actually got out of that business because his models were being used by the British in World War I to calculate the drift of poison gas clouds. And so he was a Quaker, he didn't want to have anything to do with that. He became obsessed with war, and he wrote this very eccentric book, Statistics of Deadly Quarrels, where he tried to do statistical analyses of hundreds of conflicts that took place in this time range, from very small ones to World War II. And he looked at the Malthusian theory, looked for correlation between war and resource scarcity. He also looked, another really popular theory, is that it's not poverty per se or scarcity, it's inequality that leads to war. This is something that Marx promoted. Richardson found no strong evidence for that. That's not to say that there weren't some wars that fit this model, but when you look at wars across the board, the model is not well supported. It's not predictive. All right, so then what are we left with? One of the things that was really frustrating for me, I started thinking hard about war and its causes decades ago. I was hoping that there would be a cause. And we find the cause, and then we can eliminate that cause, and then we would have a peaceful society. The remarkable thing about war is that it can break out in any society, from the most complex and large, obviously, like the United States, to the smallest little band of hunter-gatherers. So this goes back to the point about there are some scholars who really want war to start with civilization. And that just isn't true. There were some hunter-gatherer people who were engaging in war before the Neolithic and who engage in war today when they seem to have absolutely no reason to do so. Yeah. Yeah, that's a very good point. I mentioned the democratic peace phenomenon soon. So let me get back to that in a second. Democratic peace, remember that. And I just want to point out, it's, you know, rich, poor, patriarchal ones where there's more gender equality, egalitarian, hierarchical, capitalist, socialist, every society can be infected by the war meme. But another remarkable thing is that any particular society can also not engage in war. So what the hell? What's going on? Margaret Mead had the, I think, the best theory of war. This is a controversial idea because Margaret Mead is much reviled these days. Steve Pinker just wrote a rebuttal to some of my writings about war and called her the dubious Margaret Mead. So this is very, you know, some of you may be familiar with some of the criticism of Margaret Mead. It's, I think it's unfair, and in many cases it's sexist in the way that she's treated by primarily male modern scientists. Margaret Mead was a brilliant theorist, and the mistakes that she made, and of course she did make mistakes, were in no way egregious, certainly compared to modern scholars of war, including some of the ones that I've already cited here, who are propagating all kinds of bad ideas about the origins of war. So Mead wrote this essay in 1940s at the dawn of World War II. It was very hopeful, where she said war is not a biological necessity. She was addressing the deep roots theory of war, the idea that war is innate. She said war is an invention, a cultural innovation. She pointed out that there are some simple tribal societies that not only have not been observed in engaging in war, but if the anthropologists talk to them and explain what war is, the people in these societies would be astonished. They couldn't imagine such crazy behavior. Mead also pointed out that some of the simplest societies, she mentioned Aborigines in Australia, fight for no apparent reason. They fight as like a sport. She went through the major theories and presented counterexamples to each of them. So her idea was that we should see war as a cultural invention, an innovation, like some other important cultural innovations that humans have come up with and that then have been propagated for very long periods of time. So then, how did war begin in the first place? What were the reasons for the invention? I think there could be lots of reasons. So it could be fighting over females or reproductive resources, evolutionary psychologists would call them. It could be fighting over a water hole or a game area or some other resource. It could be that you have a charismatic sociopath who emerges in a tribe and just gets the idea that it'd be really cool to race around and conquer other tribes. And the thing about war that makes it such a virulent meme, Mead didn't have that term available, but if it had been invented by then, I think she would have used it, because she's really, when she says invention, that's like a synonym for meme. Once war is invented, it, in one place, it's extraordinarily infectious. You think about how this works. If you have a group of 10 peaceful tribes, one tribe suddenly gets the idea that war would be a great thing to do and starts committing acts of aggression against its neighbors, what are the neighbors going to do? They can either run away, or they can surrender, or they can fight back and become warlike themselves. And once this infection happens, it's actually because war is contrary to our nature. We require lots of brainwashing to convince ourselves that this is a really great thing to do. And especially males are trained from infancy, practically, and most societies to think of courage in battle as being the epitome of manhood. There's some great social psychology research that goes back a long time, but is still very relevant, by Stanley Milgram and Zimbardo. These are the conformity experiments, Stanford prison experiment, that I think tell us that the biggest cause of war is not innate male ferocity, which is the point of Richard Wrangham and some of the other deep roots people. It's innate conformity, if anything. We're herd creatures. And once the militarization of a society begins, then that can lead to really extraordinarily violent, vicious behavior on the part of an entire society. So there's a disturbing implication of seeing war as a cultural invention. As I said, it can infect any society. It's not as though you can get rid of religion or get rid of capitalism or get rid of patriarchy and then you will have no war. It's just not that simple. But the upside is that any society, without doing anything else dramatic, should be able to renounce war. It's something that is really an independent variable from all these other causes commonly used to explain it. So that means to get rid of war, you basically just get rid of war. You see war as a self-perpetuating behavior. Margaret Mead, even though she is described as this kind of naive, progressive, indulged in lots of wishful thinking, she wasn't at all. And I urge you to go back and read her writing. She was a very deep and subtle thinker. And she said in that 1940 essay, "Once an invention is known and accepted, men do not easily relinquish it." Certainly, the 20th century seemed to bear that out. And if you just think about how we're surrounded by reminders of wars past, we had national holidays celebrating our wars. But there are societies that get rid of war once and for all. Yeah? Yes, she did say that. I disagree with that. I think we have plenty of inventions that we have lots of ways of resolving disputes nonviolently. Just to clarify, Mead said that we needed to replace war with a new invention, which would render it obsolete. And I disagree with that. I think it just means we have to use the inventions or means of nonviolent conflict resolution more than we are now. Pardon me? Oh, like diplomacy, or even if you're talking about interpersonal violence, trial by jury, which has gotten us out of cycle of feuds and so forth.
That was the League of Nations.
Yeah. The United Nations is an attempt to renounce war. The European Union, arguably the greatest inspiration, was we could not have another one of these insane wars that has afflicted Europe for, like more than a millennia. So here, I, you know, when people are pessimistic about war, I like to point out that there are demonstration proofs that societies can go from being extremely violent and aggressive to not pacifist necessarily, but certainly not warlike very rapidly. So the Germans and Japanese are two examples. Now you would immediately say, well, yeah, but they lost. So their pacifism as such was imposed on them. Swedes and Swiss voluntarily renounced their warlike ways. You know, the Swedes were the descendants of the Vikings. They were once the scourge of Europe, racing around conquering everything in sight. I know. Nobody's perfect.
They're not in the way of getting anywhere else. And Switzerland is a terrain that's very hard.
I know. You got to have a little... Yeah. Look, I'm just trying to find reasons to hope where I can. Okay, let me go to Costa Rica. Costa Rica had a terrible civil war in the 1940s, and it had a corrupt regime that used the army to try to put down, maintain power after there was a democratic election. And that attempt failed. The new regime, one of its first decisions was, you know what, this army isn't used to protect us against invaders, it's used against Costa Ricans. So let's get rid of it. They got rid of their army. As a result, there are all these attempts to quantify the well-being of nations around the world. Costa Rica regularly comes out at the top or near the top because that money, the resources that would be invested in a military are invested in health, in transportation, in education, and promoting tourism. And to me, they're like a wonderful model of the benefits of demilitarization. You probably know also, here's another very important and much discussed trend that some scholars have been remarking on for more than a decade. Enormous decline in war-related violence since the end of World War II. Unfortunately, it's ticking up a little bit lately. Primarily because of Syria, but we're a couple of orders of magnitude below the level of carnage of the first half of the 20th century.
But Trump said things are the worst they've ever been in history.
Pardon me?
Didn't Trump say things are the worst they've ever been in history?
Yeah, I know. It's troubling. Again, there's public, because you know, we can talk about that, but there's the public perception and then there's the reality. And Pinker and I have a lot of differences, but his book, Better Angels of Our Nature, has done a magnificent job at pointing out the decline of violence at all scales, especially in Europe since the so-called Enlightenment.
So the fear is drones save lives.
Pardon me?
Drones save lives.
Drones save lives, is that what you said? Okay, we might have to get back to that. All right, just I wanted to point out, somebody brought up the democratic peace phenomenon. There are various causes cited for the decline of war-related violence. Mueller has talked about maybe we're just actually learning our lesson that war is stupid and we shouldn't do it. Globalization, economic independence, interdependence of nations has obviously grown, and that could reduce the likelihood of conflict. The democratic peace phenomenon, this was actually first suggested by Kant more than 200 years ago, the idea that non-monarchies, governments that are representative of the desires of people would be less likely to go to war. Because you know, monarchs can go to war on a whim because they often don't suffer from war, the people do. So now it's seen as a fairly robust, it's controversial, but a fairly robust phenomenon that democracies do not wage war against each other. There's a corollary that says that no two countries with a McDonald's franchise have ever waged war, which is kind of related to globalization. Yeah, okay, now the trade argument, again, this gets back to why there's no single cause that promotes peace or causes war. Right before World War I, there was a British journalist and politician who wrote a book predicting that there would be no more war in Europe because the great powers were so economically interdependent that it would be insane for them to go to war. And then they went to war. He was right. It was insane, but it didn't stop them from doing that. So that's a caveat for the trade leading to peace. Just a quick, to get the gestalt of the decline of war since the end of World War II. All right, so that's the good news, decline of war, but obviously we still live in an extremely, I'm not saying Donald Trump is right, but we live in a dangerous world. Heavily militarized, some terrible conflicts, especially in the Middle East. Some violent ideologies out there. And one of the paradoxes of democratic peace that you could see in what used to be called the Arab Spring is that the desire for democracy can lead to violence. You look at the origins of our own country. Syria, all its troubles began when you had a protest movement similar to what happened in Egypt and Tunisia that then was violently suppressed by the Syrian army. And has led to, the total shitstorm that you have today. Another problem is just the idea that war is still seen as by a civilization like our own and other civilizations as well as a perfectly legitimate solution to suppressing violence. So this is one of the things I think really pissed off Jamie. I think that the United States is the biggest warmonger in the world right now, and it's the biggest fomenter of war. I hope you know that our defense spending is as big as the next. It's almost as big as the spending of all other nations combined. The second biggest spender is China, which spends about 1/6. What we spend. We also are by far the biggest dealer of arms around the world, small arms to very sophisticated weapon systems. We're constantly innovating in weapons. We came up with this great idea, drones. Well, now everybody wants drones. And a lot of groups have them, including Hezbollah and some non-governmental groups. We are, I hope you also know this, Barack Obama, who got the Nobel Peace Prize in part because of his pledge to try to begin steps toward banning nuclear weapons once and for all, he has now embarked on a $1 trillion upgrade program of our nuclear arsenal. It's just a horrible message to send when you supposedly care about nuclear proliferation. One of the worst things is that the United States is a moral exemplar, and we are modeling behavior for the rest of the world that, to my mind, is terrible. How can we criticize Russia or even some so-called terrorist groups for engaging in horrific violent acts when we're doing so much of it? So, we're the problem, and I think I'm actually still very hopeful. I believe that that the United States could very rapidly become the leader of a global peace movement if it takes certain steps that shows demonstrate that it really means it, which would be, here are some, just start cutting the budget, and we could cut our budget by half and we'd still be much bigger than anybody else. Start closing some of the bases overseas, which cause, especially in some regions of the world, so much hostility toward us. Just start cutting back on our arms sales to the Middle East and other areas that are already loaded with weapons. How about a moratorium on weapons R&D as a way of discouraging others from coming up with possibly destabilizing new weapons? Of course, we should take steps to eradicate nuclear weapons, and be more imaginative in coming up with nonviolent methods of conflict resolution. Eric Chenoweth is, I think she's a political scientist who has done research showing how extraordinarily effective nonviolent methods of regime change, for example, can be. I think we need to change our thinking about when war is justified. That's another more intellectual work here. This is just war theory. Just war theory is generally used just to rationalize wars that we want to engage in. And I'd like to see a just war theory with some real teeth. I'm not a total pacifist. I think in some cases, violence is necessary to prevent greater violence. That's why we have police. We'll always need police. And I think we'll need some kind of global police force, but much smaller than what we have now. An absolute priority should be placed on not killing civilians, which is something that is not enough of a priority for the United States.
Well, it's okay as long as you call it collateral damage.
Right, exactly, the euphemisms. So here's how hopeful I am. I think if we have some kind of imaginative, I'm hoping that some charismatic politician can come along who sees that the anti-war movement, which now is just pathetic, can be rejuvenated and can become a really powerful political force. And it would be a natural coalition between some very unlikely groups. So, you know, the old anti-war people are still out there. I know a lot of them. And the old left types who were committed to peace. The Tea Party types who hate government go after the defense spending. It's just this horrible waste right in the middle of our budget. Religious groups. I just don't understand the backflips that religious people, Christians and Jews and Muslims, go through to justify violent acts by their governments, which are really prohibited by their scriptures. Businesses. I would love to see the heads of Google and Facebook and Amazon and Walmart take up peace as just because it's good for business. Skeptics. Why not?
Why do you say skeptics?
Because I feel as though skeptics, I just need all the help I can get. Because I feel as on this issue, people's pessimism is so deeply ingrained that I feel we need sort of professional arguers or really good arguers to be out there making the case against this terrible fatalism that people have, which in some cases is based on bad science. I know, but then you'd be wrong. All right, I've got a photograph coming up. So this is something I write a lot about. I have scientific intellectual arguments against war, and that I've already mentioned to you. This is also a moral argument, and we have. You know, the United States isn't really interested in counting civilian casualties. You have to go to human rights groups. And of course, there is enormous uncertainty. But there are lots of documented cases where U.S. forces have directly killed civilians and especially children. And to me, one of these should fill us with shame and horror. To me, it's just unacceptable. We should not be doing this. What I'm trying to do is find some kind of moral basis on which to build an argument against war. And I feel as though you shouldn't kill kids who can argue with that? But of course we do. If you've seen American Sniper, it begins with this supposed hero shooting a mother and her child. Have any of you seen that movie?
Yes.
It's a despicable, loathsome piece of propaganda, to my mind. And I actually like Clint Eastwood. I think
the child was carrying a bomb.
Right, so that justifies it. So that justifies killing children. That's the fact is that we're killing, the vast majority of children we kill and civilians we kill are not threatening U.S. troops. We sometimes run over them with our vehicles.
But you're saying killing children in any circumstance at all, including one where they're about to imminently kill dozens of others, is not justified.
So here's, by the way, the movie Fury also had as a sub-theme how you have to kill children in some situations. I think what these movies are doing is they're tapping...
As their defense. These cowards are hiding in churches, schools, and hospitals.
And that justifies it. That's what I'm challenging.
Here's the thing, it doesn't, but if you don't, then you let them get away with that.
Okay.
Yes, you will lose a few lives, but you teach them that they cannot get away with that stupidity and that cowardice, you'll still be still go
so,
like the bombs in Japan.
How come you think? Why don't they not get away with it? Why? What is it?
We are invading their country. So I would submit this obviously happened in Vietnam. We killed probably hundreds of thousands of children in Vietnam. So I would submit that if we put our troops in a situation where killing children and other civilians is necessary, then that is not a just war. Anyway, okay. Obviously,
this train is bowing down.
I know, you're talking about...
So the engineer takes the wrong, it gets a switch over and kills 200 people on the train to save the baby.
The trolley experiment.
It's the same thing. I mean, there's
a very... Classic.
Very sweet thing about the kid.
All right, let me just... Okay, so my attempt to find a kind of moral ground failed. But anyway, that's what I've tried. And by the way, I wanted to get blowback. I feel like I've been arguing this for a long time now, and I generally meet with a lot of resistance. And I'm always, it seems so obvious to me that that it is imperative that we end war. That it is not a question of will we, can we. It should be something that we demand of ourselves. We must. And then the question is how we do it. I feel as though we spend about $1 trillion, and then people ask me, well, what would you do in Syria? Or what about Israel and Palestine? What's your solution? I don't have one. I feel as though the $1 trillion we spend on national security or more should all be dedicated. Its primary mission should be to end war once and for all, to figure out a way that this never happens again, that relations between nations around the world become as benign as relations between the United States and Canada are now, let's say. And by the way, I love Obama. We're going to really miss him when he's gone, but I'm very disappointed by his war rhetoric. And here's something that I like better. You can say he's a hypocrite, because he was putting us into Vietnam when he said this. This is a speech he gave shortly before he was assassinated, that we can't think that war is inevitable. We tend to see war as like a natural disaster that's imposed on us by forces beyond our control. And it's not. It's something that we do. We choose to do. It's our invention. And we are responsible for getting rid of it, and we must get rid of it. All right, more questions. Yeah, somebody who hasn't asked you. Yeah, yeah.
So I don't think anybody in this room likes war, but I also suspect that nobody in this room likes mumps or measles either, and nobody in this room likes it when psychics or blind people take their money for planes if they're not psychic. So you're suggesting that we should just stop all that and become 100% in. Like, the skeptics movement should only care about war, and that's it.
I almost don't care about what you do as skeptics. I'm appealing to you as human beings, and I feel as though I started thinking about war because I was born in 1953. My father and grandfather both fought in World War II. I was terrified of being blown up by nuclear weapons when I was a little kid. I was eligible for the Vietnam War draft. So I was forced to think about these issues. Our country has never been more militaristic, more hawkish than it is right now, to my mind. And part of that is not even questioning the extreme militarism of our own country. So that's what I'm trying to get people to think about. Go ahead and do all that stuff, other stuff. Worry about homeopathy, but I... Yeah. I don't take anything back that I said last spring, but this is a talk that I could give to any group, but I do think that skeptics would be, what I like about skeptics is that you do examine your own thinking more than most people. I didn't bring up vaccines. There were some things that I didn't bring up because, I'm worried about the backlash against vaccines too. What are you saying? I hurt your feelings? I mean, do you want me to apologize? Okay, sure.
All the way at the start. Stuff I question is stuff you shouldn't do. When stuff like, we do question these things. We question these things all the time. You're saying questioning neuroscience and things like that. We had one day at NECSS that was science-based medicine.
Uh-huh.
It was a whole day talking about everything that you say we should be questioning about in biology, neuroscience, and medicine. It was a whole day on these topics. It feels like you see the skeptic movement as what it was 20 or 30 years ago, as opposed to what it has evolved to today.
Okay, so I'll talk a little bit about the medical stuff, and some of this I said a little bit in the follow-up posts I wrote after my initial speech, and it's reacting to what Novella and Gorski, how they reacted to my talk and how they criticized it. And so Gorski said, "I write about mammograms all the time, and you totally ignored that," and Novella criticized and he also said that he was concerned about problems in psychiatry, but then he criticized my citation of this book, Anatomy of an Epidemic. The problem I have with those guys, and I think this is a systemic problem in skepticism, and of course there are going to be exceptions, is that there's a little bit of guild defense. So in other words, I see these two guys, they are physicians with specialties, and they are worried about alternative medicine as a competitor to what they see as real medicine.
They are worried about people being defrauded, people being scammed, people going to alternative medicine instead of real medicine and dying because of it.
So the problem I have is that... All I can do is look at their writing. So Novella, when he dismissed the work of this guy Robert Whitaker, he said the guy's a journalist. What does he know?
I don't know that particular citation that you're talking about, but when it comes to medicine, especially neuroscience, he is an expert in that area. He, as skeptics, when someone is an expert in an area where you can be an expert in an area that's well established, and we have to defer to those people.
Right.
Okay, so and that's the other thing too as well. You have all of the things that they talk about, when they refute something or support something, they always put citations, they always put references, so you can go and look those things up yourself. If you look at them, well, we went through this entire thing right now, and every single slide that you had over here, the slide was one person put their name out and then attribute things to them. No references. No,
listen, if you want to, I wrote a book called The End of War, and it's got a very long list of sources at the end.
So the part of how skeptical you think about when it's communicating to the public at the moment is you don't need to read these long, large books. You don't need to go digging deep. You can if you want to, but we try to make it also as accessible and easy to see these references as possible. I guarantee you, without even going back right now, to Novella's quotes, I guarantee you everything that he said over there, one was measured and metered,
okay,
and with references cited as to why that position is.
Well, I'm sorry, I wasn't there, so I don't know. You know, all I can do is respond to the things that he said in response to me, and I thought that he was unfair, that he had a double standard for judging his own field. I don't care. Obviously, in my position as a science journalist, I don't care if you're a tenured professor at Yale. I'm trying to look at the merits of the arguments that you have and the evidence that you cite. So it's my job to challenge people, whether they are tenured professors at Harvard or Yale, or whether they're Deepak Chopra.
A number of other people are trying to raise their hand and raise things, including an less represented gender here. So I don't think we should have one person dominate all the questions.
Okay, are there other questions? I get it, maybe we can talk afterwards. Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry, you haven't asked a question yet. Yeah. No, that's not.
We live in a reality right now.
We don't all agree.
I'm not saying it's inevitable, but I'm saying that right now we live in a reality. And when you have a mother and child carrying a bomb, that they're going to blow themselves up along with several million people.
That was a movie. Can I answer that?
I did, yes.
I thought it was obvious from what I'm saying. I wanted to begin with, so a majority of people here thought that war won't end. Like, let's say, okay, but right. I mean, let's say by the end of the century. So here, I'm actually hopeful that war could end very rapidly if there is an upswelling of popular support by it. So another reason why I'm hopeful that these dramatic changes can happen is because of the end of the Cold War. So if in 1985, if you had said that the Soviet Union, one of the most brutal empires in history, would voluntarily dissolve itself and yield its power and that the Cold War would end, people would have said you were nuts. The same was true of apartheid in South Africa. So these changes can happen very recently. Somebody, pardon me? What, the Soviet Union? No, Gorbachev took steps that led, and the guy Yeltsin, after him, that was not something that was just a spontaneous dissolution. It actually was catalyzed by people at the very top. But the point is that this very seemingly intractable situation changed very rapidly. Okay, so here, let me give you another thing that I trot out to try to make people more optimistic and see the difference between war and some other problems. So we were talking about the analogy. Somebody mentioned cancer. So what will it take to cure cancer? Well, we don't know. It's possible cancer might never be cured because cancer, unlike war, is a product of the complexity of our biology. It might be related more than anything just to entropy. A friend of mine, George Johnson, wrote a book about cancer, and that was his conclusion. It just becomes more likely as the older you get, more things can go wrong. So maybe we will succeed at some point, but maybe we won't. War, on the other hand, could end tomorrow. Very small number of people around the world could mutually agree to stop all violent acts committed by people under their control, and there would be no war. You could have a global ceasefire. I know it sounds wildly implausible to you. I'm just trying to point out the difference between certain problems that are really intractable because they're part of nature, and others that are self-determined. Yeah.
Why is it that ceasefires don't hold?
Well, in some cases they do. So look, again, yes, but remember, war is declining. Look at the European Union. I hope you would agree that it's inconceivable now that there could be war between France and Germany. All right? Do you know that there were tensions between the United States and Canada as recently as, I don't know, like 150 years ago? And now it's inconceivable. So these things happen. Right.
You know, so I think that amongst people in prosperous societies, in democratic societies, amongst people of goodwill who have something to protect,
yes,
love their children, that's the state's line, versus all the other two, I need to get them to stop having war. But they will be bad actors who want to undermine that system.
I think there will always be crazy, violent people. I think there always probably will be violent, apocalyptic cults. I do think we'll need some kind of peace force. But the idea that a modern nation state will be, okay, it's a weird time to be saying this. In the United States because of what's happening in our current presidential election. But I actually, maybe it's faith. I have faith that is the arc of human history, that we are going to the point where a Hitler is impossible, where you will not have that kind of mass psychosis anymore because... Well, for one thing, because people learn from history. It didn't work out so well for the Nazis. What my hope is that I think it's inconceivable now that we could go back to a period of mass enslavement where slavery will be legalized again and people will start to think that that's a good thing again. There is, I believe, in the arc of moral progress, and I think it's clear-cut, recognition of universal human rights, and obviously, you know, sometimes it's a step backward and then two steps forward, but that's the direction we're going in. I think war is one of the last things that
we're...
We have to brainwash ourselves. We have
to...
This is a kind of positive. Is that? Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
This idea of the bad actor, your bad actor, may be my freedom fighter. Where do you get your moral power to say he is a bad actor? I am a good actor. You know, this is.
By the way, let me just make one other point about, again, the sort of progress, moral progress. Let's say 100 years ago, 120 years ago, there were very few what you would really call democratic regimes around the world. And none of them were democratic if you consider that none of them gave women the right to vote. So they were democratic sort of anomaly compared to modern standards. Now about two-thirds of the human population lives under some kind of democratic regime. Now even in our own country, we have severe problems. Our democracy is compromised and so forth. But again, that you're looking at the broad direction of history, it's very positive, and democracy, in spite of the problems that initially it can lead to more violence, is correlated very strongly with peace. So that gives me hope as well. Yeah, you and then you.
I just want to say, I think you've been very clear. If I have a goal here, it's crystal clear that is something, an assumption I've had that I've never questioned, but I think it's very good to bring it up and say, well, this is another point that can be questioned as a skeptic, but it does very well. And I think I've taken something away from that. I'd also like to say, as a patient, what you're saying in this talk is actually pretty mainstream. And I applaud you for your.
I'm sorry, it's pretty.
Mainstream.
Oh, okay.
I don't think it would be surprising or get a lot of argument in most of Europe or in Canada. So I think, you know, it's obviously going to be challenging to present that material in this.
Well, listen, I've given this talk in Europe also, and wherever I go, it's still like, you know, 80-90% of the audience thinks war is a permanent part of the human condition.
I like it too, but just that you're saying about the over-militarization and
right.
The other assumptions, I think are mainstream thoughts, I'm sure.
But so I'm trying to connect them. I'm trying to connect people's fatalism to some of these bad ideas. Anyway, yes, and then. Yeah.
We had a very large anti-war movement.
That's right.
And it did not succeed.
Right.
It just didn't succeed. So I don't see how it does. And then the other thing you said was that slavery, we would never go back to slavery. But as I just shouted out, there is an estimated 26 to 46 million slaves today.
Right.
A multi-billion dollar.
Around the world.
You can't stop war by just stopping it here.
Absolutely.
You can't stop slavery by just stopping it here.
Okay, but you're not equating this, what you're calling slavery now, and there is certainly severe economic exploitation of workers, with what was the case 200 years ago, like mass legal, real slavery, where people are treated as chattel. But it's a shadow economy that is not like the legalized slavery that we had in this country that was practiced by presidents.
I understand that it was practiced by a different class of people, but it's still being practiced.
Will you just grant me that we're moving in the right direction?
I hope so, but I have a very pessimistic view.
Yeah.
I see war between nations as analogous to crime between persons.
Right.
And we've made a lot of progress in the last couple of centuries. Like walking from here to the Bronx, much safer now than it was 200 years ago.
Empirically.
There's a lot more robberies if you look at the statistics.
Right.
But a lot of how this was accomplished is we have a police force that has a monopoly on violence.
Right.
And so if we were to go to where, you know, if everybody just demilitarizes voluntarily, I can see where we could wind up with North Korea and the rest of the world, where North Korea is not participating in this.
as I said, there, you know, the transition to a largely demilitarized world could be tricky. And I the idea of total demilitarization doesn't make sense. I know some hardcore pacifists, you know, like real Quakers, War Resisters League. I haven't met one, I don't think, that believes that we should get rid of police, which means that none of them are absolute pacifists. There's a maniac running down the street with a gun or a knife. You want to have professionals who can deal with that situation. You need something comparable on a larger scale in case some groups start getting crazy. But it's
at what point on this list are places that don't carry guns?
Pardon me?
There are police forces that don't carry guns.
Right.
This is the point when you're saying it's not necessarily having a bigger gun.
And I think this is, you know, that if you want to get more detailed, then we would talk about arms control or gun. Yeah, anti-gun laws and all that kind of stuff, because that's connected to this problem too. Yeah.
I think the nature of aggression between nations is going to change, and I don't think realistically that a sovereign power is going to attack the United States militarily. It's just not going to happen. But we could be the victim of a cyber attack, for example, which could come from a sovereign power.
Right.
Clandestine. So the nature of aggression is going to change. We're being attacked, you know, huge sporadically by members of these splinter groups that are decentralized. And that's a whole different, you can't mass an army and go after them. We've tried that, it's not working.
Right, I'm highly skeptical. We just had the former director of the CIA come and give a talk at my school, Michael Hayden, and was all, you know, scaring us with cyber attacks and so forth. And I know there are some genuine threats there, but we are the dominant force in the cyber realm around the world. We have by far the most sophisticated cyber defenses and cyber offenses anywhere in the world, and we are the innovators in cyber war also. So I think that there's a lot of bullshit about the threats, the cyber threats to our security. And you have to remember that the defense establishment is looking for any new justifications of their sky-high budgets. And cyber war is one of the latest.
Yeah, we seem not to question the dominance of nation states on the global stage. My personal feeling is that I think we're unlikely to stop war until we have global democracy, single rule of law, single global police force, that sort of thing. Just as the states of
I don't think. See, the problem I have with the one world, the one government solution, which has been very popular in the past. Einstein, I think, talked about that. But it's just very difficult to conceive how it would happen. I don't like any solutions that are so radical that they defer world peace way into the future. I think the European Union, I don't know if you're talking about that on a global scale, but that's a pretty loose federation with lots of autonomy in the member states. That's plenty, I think. You look at Steven Pinker just wrote an essay about how there's no war officially because of some ceasefire in Colombia in the Western Hemisphere right now, which is extraordinary. And so, you know, nations in various regions can just come to the recognition. It's just stupid. If you look at the consequences of the wars that the United States has engaged in since 9/11, they've been so bad for us in so many ways, economically, in terms of our moral reputation, about a million American soldiers on disability. It's been terrible. We're going to be paying the cost of that forever. And what have we got? Look at Iraq. It's arguably worse now than it was under Saddam Hussein. Afghanistan. Are we going to be in Afghanistan forever? So it just seems to me that you can look at these wars on a strictly practical level. Forget even the moral issue. Forget about dead kids. They've been just dumb. And
9/11, you know, before time, and others advocated police response. Yeah.
Right.
And they were mocked for it.
Right.
And that, in my mind, was the right way to go. But how do you implement police response
this is, again, I said, $1 trillion security establishment. Yeah, no, when you count, the State Department, you know, you put together all the security spending, and it's actually well over $1 trillion if you count domestic security, I mean, FBI and other domestic security. It's security. All right, okay, so let's say $700 billion, but $1 trillion is regularly used by people who know what they're talking about. So James Fallows used that figure in The Atlantic recently. Those people should be thinking about this problem. So I feel like it shouldn't be on me to come up with solutions. Have those people who are specialists. So right now, what I figured by now somebody would say, well, what would you do about ISIS in Syria? I have no idea. I think one of the first things to do is to recognize that that is a problem that we largely helped to create. And then our responsibility should be, first thing, don't make it worse. And injecting more arms and armed forces into that region, it looks like we're going to do that. Hillary Clinton has already talked about how she might do that. I think that's a really stupid idea. That doesn't mean I know what to do about it. But all those people should be trying to come up with solutions.
Well, what about the argument that this peaceful phase that we're in since 1945 is in large part the Pax Americana, in large part because, as Chris was pointing out, America is the world's policeman.
Right.
You know, so I mean, yes, trade is also a major stabilizing factor, but also we have become the world's policeman. And
I agree, and I think it's unsustainable. I think it's the problem, the side effects of that. I'm sure there'd be ways to quantify the benefits of China's aggression is so minuscule compared to our own. They're operating on the margins of their own borders. We are spanning the world with our global military empire. I think China looks at our actions and they hope we keep doing what we're doing because we are actually undermining our own power by our use of military force around the world. That has been the justification, and I don't believe it. I think, you know, I'm worried about Putin.
Yeah.
Much more than I am about the leaders of China. And we still live in a very dangerous period defined by war and the threat of war. So the transition period to this peaceful future that I hope for is going to be very difficult. As I said, I think it could be much quicker than that. But people have to believe it's possible and have to see it as an absolute priority. I think it should be a priority over global warming. I think it's the biggest and most immediately solvable problem that humanity has right now. And if you think about, I'm going to stick with the $1 trillion. You think about the $1 trillion as a resource, it's wasted energy, money, human power, human ingenuity that could be diverted into solving climate change and some of these other problems.
I think we're missing a huge and very relevant part of this discussion.
Pardon me?
I think we're missing a huge and very relevant part of this discussion.
Okay.
Given that this is a skeptics group.
Right.
So you have U.S. military going into places like Syria, in some cases with cross-dangling from the gun. And what we're talking about here is all kinds of talk about ISIS, and we hear all kinds of militarism in this room.
Yeah.
So, oh my God, those people are going to blow us up, and we've got to get in there with all our military. But this is a room of intelligent people who are able to talk about religion. Where is the addressing of Islamic fundamentalism and jihadism in this discussion? Because the Americans as a country are seen as Christian, and they are rolling in with Christian fundamentalists as a large portion of our soldiers
right.
into these Islamic countries. How is that ever going to solve anything? And what responsibility do the people in this room have to influence that?
I'm not sure I... There's always an abundance of hypocrisy when people claim to be pursuing moral progress, but that doesn't mean that the progress isn't real.
But that's not your definition of that.
Yeah, well, just going back to the point about religion, there are some skeptics. I don't like the way that Dawkins and Harris and Coyne talk about religion, because, so I reviewed a book by Jerry Coyne, and I was very, very mean about it, because he just said a lot of ridiculous, unfounded things about religion as the source of all evil in the world. It's just wrong. He was pretty. He even blamed religion on blamed global warming on religion somehow, or said that global.
There are some connections, but we
not
are
really. It's capital. It's capitalism.
Says global warming isn't happening because of the book of Genesis.
It's a ridiculous argument to bring up because. Because capitalism is such a trivial, renders religion trivial.
Okay. If I can, I want to start wrapping this up. Benny has asked me that he wants to just have one more question. He's our founder, so Benny, I'm going to give the final question, Benny, and then Danny is actually. After this, we're going to be going over to the Globe. A restaurant. It's on 23rd Street between 3rd and Lexington. When you get out, make a right, make one more right, and it should be on this side of the street. We're all going to be going out there for dinner and drinks. We're going to be treating John as long as you're welcome to come on our dime.
Sure.
And drink whatever you like. You can drink even the top shelf stuff. we put you through this today.
I don't drink, but maybe I'll start.
Yeah, it might be a good idea.
So it's not a fascinating discussion on war and whether we should be war or not. That's a fascinating discussion, but you number six items there that, as you say, you as a skeptics movement should be questioning as well. And I think what you question during the NECSS talk is the fact that we don't worry about those.
Right.
That we only worry about things like Bigfoot.
I told you. Put Bigfoot in there because Jamie Swiss ranted about Bigfoot and how important it was right before I went on the stage and pissed me off. So,
we had a discussion where we had capitalism this year, the street theory, the whole panel question.
Excellent.
We had a whole panel where we discussed the ascent of technology and all of that. Do you still think we don't question those things?
No, you guys are great.
Thank you. No, I don't want to. That's ancient history. We've all moved on. I think it's a dialectic, and we've there's been some moral progress here on my part. Thank you very much.
Before you guys leave, just a couple more words. First of all, thank you so much for coming back.
Sure.
Feel free to come out with us for a whole lot of other events and come out and have a drink with us and keep the discussion going. Thank you.